Broadcasting Network. 'Cause you make me feel like I've been locked out of hell. Anywhere. This is your sound. This is the sound of Universal Broadcasting Network at UPNRadio.com.
Well, greetings and salutations, everyone. Helps if I turn on my microphone. Welcome to Dr. Judy WTF. I am your host, Walt Lusk. And, of course, we have the illustrious and beautiful and sexy Dr. Judy Rosenberg in studio. We are Network. We're in Hollywood at the Sunset Gower Studios. And today we have a fun show. We're going to really do a little follow-up of our show last week on HIV. And then we're going to dive right in to affairs. Mm-hmm. And we also are going to do Shrink That Tune, as we do every week, and we've got a pretty tainted one this week. So and this is a call-in show, folks. If you want to call in and participate, get on the couch with Dr. Judy. The phone number is area code 323-284-7826, and we'll put you right on air, and I promise we're not going to be that challenging.
Yeah, and even though the topic is about affairs, please call in anyway. You can use another name if you like. You don't have to, announce to the world your real name, because I'm looking to really look at the patterns and get you guys talking about your opinions on all the topics that we're going to be bringing up tonight. So please do call in.
And we're talking about not only WTF is going on in the world, but WTF is going on in your world. Mm-hmm. So get on the couch. I promise it'll be fun. So
you promise?
Oh, absolutely. And you have no idea.
That's scary, Walt. That's scary.
I know. So last week with HIV, on the September 18th in the United States, it was National HIV, AIDS, and Aging Awareness Day. 30% of those with HIV are over age 50. And they're, coming into cognitive and physical challenges. Mm-hmm. And for this group, mostly men, the AIDS generation, there is no life without HIV. With the loss of a lot of their friends that have HIV, right, and death, as mm-hmm. well as the illness and the emotional and social burdens. So it's a challenging thing. And we've got a couple of resources for you if you want to do a little more research. We've got AIDS.gov, which is a great site. The Body, BODY.com, is a community-oriented major AIDS and HIV conferences, online community discussion, and stuff you can ask experts. And the last one is UNAIDS.org. Mm-hmm. It's United Nations on a global scale. And so we can use those as resources. If you want to know more information, you can obviously go to our website and contact us at info@drjudywtf.com as well.
Yeah, and I just want to mention that HIV, as you all know, is not the only sexually transmitted disease. And I want to talk a little bit, before I launch into affairs, because these topics are obviously related, I want to talk about...
Do they go hand in hand?
They go other places and other
hand
places.
Hand in glove?
Kind of like that. So, so I want to talk a little bit about what to do if you're faced with a truth conversation between you and your partner, your potential partner, and how do you handle these delicate situations? So talking about if you have HIV, if you are carrying the human papilloma virus, HPV, which I believe now 60-70% of the population are carriers of the HPV virus.
I didn't realize it was that huge
of
a number.
It's that high, yeah, it is. And the men are the carriers and the women are the happy recipients, unfortunately.
The happy recipients.
The happy recipients,
okay.
Right. And so how it manifests in women is it ups the incidence of cervical cancer. So these are necessary.
Chlamydia does the same thing.
It does.
Yeah.
Okay, what about herpes? Does that up the cervical cancer rate?
Not that I know of. I've had. I used to work in a laboratory where we process it years and years ago. And
okay.
I don't think so. There are other ramifications, but not that issue.
Okay, so this is an ethical thing, you guys. If you are carriers of any sort of communicable disease, then it's really not about you only. And you owe it to the people around you, your partners, to have that conversation so they can decide how they want to handle the situation, which doesn't mean that they're not going to have sex with you, by the way. That's not at all what it means. It just means that they may want to take extra precautions. They may want to study up on what that means to them. And in any case, we are all responsible for protecting ourselves. Okay, so whether somebody converses with us or not, it is our lives, it's our health, our bodies, and we need to stay safe. And the best way we could stay safe is not to rely on other people's information.
That's absolutely true. And if you remember from our guest last week, Kurt, he got AIDS from someone who didn't know they had AIDS. Mm-hmm. And they had gotten sick, and amazingly enough, in their situation, they got better pretty quick and obviously mm-hmm. were positive HIV. And he was in a point in his life where he was not being cautious and protective, and mm-hmm. ended up with it. He was very responsible in his approach, but bottom line, mm-hmm. His partner didn't even know.
Right. So folks, have that conversation. It's the ethical thing to do. And so we're going to segue from sexually communicative diseases right into the topic of
affairs.
Yes.
Which really is, which Judy and I were talking about earlier this week, which I thought was great, a silent system changer.
Mm-hmm.
It's really a lie, mm-hmm. but it's a silent system changer. Mm-hmm. It's a system of disconnect, which the show is obviously about healing human disconnect.
Yeah, so let me elaborate. A silent system changer means that someone is changing the system, meaning the person having an affair is changing the system. It's silent because the other person who he's cheating on doesn't know, or at least doesn't know consciously. And then there's this whole restructuring of the system going on, and everything seems out of joint, but the person in the dark doesn't exactly know why. So the system is changing. It's just that the other person doesn't exactly know what is going on and why things are different, why their person is seemingly more distant, for example, why their person's grooming habits are changing. Maybe the person is spending a lot more time texting
away.
Yeah,
more ways than one.
Right, yeah. And stories are not lining up, and their cologne suddenly changes. Okay, and
maybe they're wearing more cologne.
Or wearing more cologne, yeah. Right? Okay, so there are a lot of signs of affairs. However, however that affair is manifesting itself, it's another example of a symptom. And just to go to my mind map for a moment, Walt, if you will, I created a mind map called Be the Cause. And Be the Cause is a system of tracking where the problem comes from and dismantling the problem and paradigm shifting into solutions. So I want to map out, I want to mind map out an affair here, okay?
And the mind map is a system Judy developed. It's 9 panels, as we call them, mm-hmm. and she's been doing this for about 12 years. And the success she's had in her therapy has been, frankly, unbelievable. We'll talk about some testimonies, but there you go.
Yeah, so I want to mind map an affair, and I want to start backwards. I want to start with the symptom, which is the actual affair. Someone is disgruntled in their marriage, or the wife comes in and says, I think my husband's cheating on me. Or sometimes the husband will come in, or the partner will come in and say, you know, I'm having an affair, or I'm engaging in hiring prostitutes, or I'm basically going outside the boundaries of the marriage. And so now I don't know what to do. I don't know what to say. I don't know what conversations to have. So the first thing that I want to say to people listening is that an affair is a symptom. It's a symptom.
It is a symptom.
It's a symptom of disconnect. Okay, so if you put that mind map up there, the first disconnect we have is the disconnect between, guess who? Well,
Well, ourselves, I would imagine.
Yeah, that's our first, well, the very first disconnect and the very first relationship we have with our mother. Yeah, our primary caregivers. So it all goes back to cause. And when I say cause, I mean the primary caregiver. So when a person is having an affair, it's really a manifestation that there's something missing. And usually what we need as human beings is the same thing we've always needed as human beings, which is that from birth we need connection, we need eye contact, we need skin contact,
yep.
We need mirroring, we need obviously unconditional love, we need to know that we're safe, we need to know that we're important, and we need to know from a newborn perspective, meaning let's call it the first 1, 2, 3 years of life, we need to know that we are number one. So what's an affair? Affair means simply, you know what, baby? You're not number one anymore. I've got another person there. So where does that whole consciousness starts? It's where does this start? It starts with the idea that there was a disconnect way back there at cause, which is in the first few years of life. And that becomes the blueprint for what happens later. And this, again, I see as just another symptom of that disconnect. So working backwards, we're going from some sort of a going outside of the relationship because the needs are not being met. When we are in our primary caretaker's homes, when we're in our parents' home, can we go outside the system?
No.
No, we
no,
can't.
No, are you talking about when we're children?
Right.
Well, no, I mean, if you've said, and one of the things you say is, mm-hmm. childhood is a hostage situation.
Exactly. Okay, so we're hostages
we're
of childhood.
Stuck.
We're kind of stuck. We can't get our needs met. So, whoa. Okay, so in that situation, we're really stuck. But once we understand that we're not getting our needs met, our core beliefs are then based on how unimportant we feel because we haven't gotten our needs met, and then we pick a partner who doesn't need our needs, right? And then, wow, we're wondering, whoa, we haven't gotten our needs met. We're in a partnership that doesn't meet our needs, and now we want to kind of supplement a little bit.
Yeah, well, what's interesting is, yeah, it's an unhealthy relationship that we're trying to fix the unhealthy relationship we had as children, but then that luster probably dies, and so we go into relationship.
Right.
And then we jump into another unhealthy relationship. So we're trying to fix another unhealthy relationship with another unhealthy relationship.
Well,
and therefore, it's kind of unhealthy.
Yeah. So there's unhealth at core, at cause. Okay. And then because we didn't bond in a healthy manner, we now choose partners that are not the healthiest because we're not the healthiest. And then because one and one does not exactly make two, or definitely not creating any, as I put it, light and synergy, we now have one person plus one person, and they're in this relationship, and the ship is going down because they're basically vampiring each other. They don't have a lot of what I call emotional goodies or supplies. So
well, there's some goodies
like
somewhere.
Yeah, there's some goodies, but it's, you know, come on, don't hit below the belt like that, okay? But, you know, there are not enough emotional goodies in the situation. So if there's not enough emotional goodies, or even if there aren't enough sexual goodies in the package, then the natural tendency is if you don't know how to have that, what I call peaceful healing conversation that creates connection, that creates healthy communication, so that each party can now begin to understand how to meet each other's needs, then that silence itself will direct people outside of the system, and then they will start looking to supplement their needs with other people, which then creates a whole bunch of chaos. So why don't you go from panel.
Well, there's lots of
go
chaos
ahead.
Because, I mean, for example, if you're talking to, I'll just do it from a guy's perspective, mm-hmm. if your spouse or girlfriend or lover, you know, you really goof them up and say they're too fat, they're too old, you know, they're not pretty, you know, they're too ugly, mm-hmm. you know, you start attacking them, you know, that presents more chaos.
Yeah, right. And then that really zings right into that other person's core belief that they're not good enough,
right.
They're not important enough,
they're not lovable enough.
Exactly. So just to show you how this works, okay? So the first wound is the disconnect between the mother and the infant. And then this wound creates a reaction, and that reaction is dependent on how deep and how chronic the wound continues over time. And then that particular set of circumstances creates a core belief within us, something like, well, maybe I'm not that important, or I'm not that lovable, or I'm not that special. And then that core belief is the blueprint for who we ultimately pick to create a system with, to bond with. And if that bond is based on our broken psyche, so to speak, if it's based on the darkness that we have absorbed into our system, then it will not sustain. So if you don't mind putting up panel number 3, which is the DNA, which is the...
Well, that's the encoding of the wound, right?
That's right. The encoding of the wound, and I'm using this DNA strand as a metaphor for the bonding between partners. And if those bonds are not substantial, built on integrity, built on... mind to mind, spirit to spirit, body to body, ethically
connected. Yeah.
If it's not ethically connected, then the whole thing is basically going to fall apart into
chaos. Will be the next panel, which is what happens. And that's where a lot of people get stuck, mm-hmm. is they are in that situation where they're... they don't know how to get out of it. They don't know how to repair it, how to fix it. And sometimes since they've been in it for so long and they're familiar with it, they stay.
Yeah. And then there's also a collusion going on, because I've spoken to a lot of patients about this, and just about all my patients who were cheated on have a gut feeling that there was something going on. There's an intuition there. So,
and if you have an intuition or a mm-hmm. gut feeling, or this resonates with you just a little bit, then you know what you want to do. Get on the couch, get on the phone, and call us. Our telephone mm-hmm. number is area code 323-284-7826, mm-hmm. and we'll put you on air, and I swear, it'll be fun.
Yeah, and again, if you don't want to use your real name, just invent a name. I mean, I don't know. Call yourself.
I used to listen to a show a long time ago. All the girls would call, and they were George.
George?
Yeah, their
really?
Name was George. Hi, I'm George.
Not even Georgie?
No, it was
like
George.
That? Just
That's
George.
Funny.
Okay,
yeah.
So I really am excited about getting some calls today, because I want you guys to put my mind to work, because I'm here at your service, free therapy, okay? And so please do. So in the meantime, I want to detail this thing out a little bit further. I want to flesh it out, if you will. Okay, so what is an affair? An affair is really something unfair. It is not fair. And it's not fair because actually mental health and ethics go hand in hand. So if there's a case where there's been damage done at cause in those first few years of life, people tend to try to make up for those losses later on in life. And one of the ways to make up for the loss of not having that special bond between mother and infant, one way to make up for the loss of not being special and important and nurtured and contacted and connected with, is by having maybe more than one person deliver more goods to you. So if you can understand that, again, this is psychopathology based behavior. It's not having an affair is not it's not like what you think it is. It's not like, oh, I had an affair. No, there's a whole history here. There's a whole psychological history behind it. And in treating the people that come to see me, I've got to consider the history so that they can begin to understand that.
Well, the background and the foundation of what the cause
Correct.
Was. Because if we don't get to that, there's
Correct.
No reason, there's no basis or hope for fixing it.
And you know what's really sad is that oftentimes people don't really, really want to have an affair. They just want to be close to another human being. They don't really want to sabotage a closeness, what most people are looking
for.
Well,
that's why there's two kinds of affairs, right? There's the physical kind, mm-hmm. and then there's the emotional kind,
mm-hmm.
right?
Right.
And
right.
both can be, I mean, if you're online a lot at night and instant messaging with somebody, mm-hmm. I mean, heck, they could be across the country.
And oftentimes they are.
Yeah.
And oftentimes people will have affairs, long distance affairs, because there's another psychopathology going on, which is that they don't want to get that emotionally close.
Yeah, they don't want to get involved, and
That's
they think
right.
it's safe.
Yes.
But it's not.
Yep. Yeah. Right. Actually, I was treating a patient of mine who is very in love with the woman that he's with. However, he has sexual addiction, so he goes for porn stars, and it's going to kill his relationship, obviously. And he's beginning to see that really the most dangerous relationship he has currently is with the person he loves the most. That is the most dangerous relationship a person can have, is with the person you love the most, because if you've been damaged in the past, if you've had a history of people who you love the most leave you, it's pretty dangerous to put your heart out there again.
You bet. I mean, it's really hard to be vulnerable, let alone to rebound and bounce back.
Right.
And that's why a lot of guys go to hookers, is because you're not quote paying them for what they're doing. You're paying them for leaving. You know, I mean, once the time you have with them is over, they're gone, and there's no complications, and they're not going to knock on your front door at 3 a.m. or call you incessantly and
right.
have all those entanglements. You're paying them basically to leave and leave you alone after you've done what you've done.
Exactly. And if you've been wounded deeply at the core in the arena of relationship and the primary relationship, then the last thing you want to do is get that close to another human being. So what's the best way to not get that close to another human being is to spread it around. Have a few people in your life. Have at least one extra person in your life.
And is that maybe, like, you can't have too many friends?
It's kind of like that.
Or is that kind of like a virus?
Yeah, it's like kind of like, yeah. Yes.
It was interesting, for example, an affair that went a long time, close to 30 years back in the day, was Katharine Hepburn and mm-hmm. Spencer Tracy. Mm-hmm. Spencer Tracy never divorced his wife because he was a good Catholic, but he was very, very guilt-ridden for it. They were 9 films together, and he's a very hard drinker and guilt-ridden Catholic. But, his wife, Louise, Spencer Tracy's, suffered in silence for all those years. She was very devoted to her son, who, his name was Tracy, but he was deaf.
So back in those days, there weren't a lot of books out on communication.
No.
Right?
No.
So people just did that. They suffered in silence. But this is a really interesting case, I think, because what's her name? Louise?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
Louise.
That was...
John Tracy was the son.
Okay, so Louise, who was married to Spencer Tracy, had a son, John, who was born deaf. And one of the comments that... Spencer made when he heard the news that his son was deaf was, "Oh my God, he's never gonna be able to say daddy."
That's correct.
I mean, what do you think of that,
Spencer,
Walt?
Didn't even know that his son was deaf. Of course, they didn't know he was deaf either, but it was 4 months mm-hmm. after Louise's wife figured out his son was deaf that he told him.
But
tells you how involved he was.
I'd love to hear your opinion. What do you think about the comment? The first time you hear that your son is deaf, the comment out of your mouth is, "Oh my God, he's never going to be able to say daddy."
That's pretty narcissistic.
That's pretty narcissistic.
If I do say so myself.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. So oftentimes people have affairs, not oftentimes, but sometimes people have affairs when there's a lot of stress in the family. And this is not an uncommon thing, that if there's a baby that is born with a birth defect, if there's some sort of a very, very unusual stressor in the family, then oftentimes the couples will not be able to sustain the marriage. And in order to hold everything together, they will reach for some other partner who maybe is outside the system and not really drenched in the traumas and the dramas and the everyday medical conversations, the everyday sorrows.
Is that another way of trying to fill in the hole in the soul?
Another way, right. Definitely. So by all means, when we have psychosocial stressors in life, meaning when life bears down on us in heavy-duty ways, the stress can sometimes become so unbearable that we need other coping mechanisms. And an affair is what I call an unhealthy defense mechanism.
Yeah, it could be. Well, so how stressed is dealing with another one of folks that had a lady that had a lot of affairs. How stressed was Elizabeth Taylor? Taylor had 8 marriages during her life. She started at age 18 and married Conrad Hilton, and yes, that's mm-hmm. Conrad Hilton of the Hilton Hotels. Mm-hmm. And they had a 3-month honeymoon and 5 months at home. They were done. Got divorced. Didn't even last a year.
Okay, so let me just comment on that. What do you think she was going for there, Conrad Hilton?
Again, he was famous and had money.
Okay, so perhaps she was going for the money. So let's talk about what holds couples together. So how much of a bonding force is cash?
I would think, more marriages break up over money mm-hmm. than any other. So it's obviously a very important one, a very potent one.
Yeah, it's a very important factor in a marriage, because a marriage is about surviving in our world. And without cash, it's hard to do that.
In this economy, there's a lot of couples I know and read that get mm-hmm. divorced mm-hmm. and obviously living together under the same house, but they can't afford to move or leave.
Yes.
So they're under the same roof, but they're not married.
Yes, that's right.
Yeah.
So in order to hold that bond together in an integrity way, you've got to have more than cash. So that explains why
bachelor number one didn't quite make it.
Immediately
after divorcing, 3 months at the end of that first marriage, she tied the knot. I mean, 3 months later, she's already getting married again to a British actor named Michael Wielding.
So she
went for an actor, right?
Okay, so she went from cash to fun.
Yeah,
Go ahead. How long did the fun last?
And they were divorced in 1957. I don't know how long that lasted.
Do the math. Was it shorter or longer?
Oh, it was longer. Yeah, they had 2 sons.
So the fun
Michael
lasted.
And Christopher.
Okay, so fun got him further.
Yeah,
go
fun
ahead.
Got him further.
So who was husband number three,
uh-huh. almost immediately after divorcing husband number two,
yes.
she went for a film producer, Michael Todd. Okay. However, this one ended tragically. He was killed in a plane crash during the first year of their marriage.
Okay.
So it was a very freak plane crash that went to New Mexico.
Okay.
So that kind of ended differently.
Okay, so she went for creativity and power.
Creativity.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. However, husband number four, Todd, her husband who died, was a very close friend of Eddie Fisher.
Oh,
yes.
Okay.
Who was, of course, married at that time to Debbie Reynolds,
mm-hmm.
right?
Mm-hmm.
And so 14 months after Todd's death, a little over a year, now she is married to Eddie Fisher, who, of course, had to divorce Debbie Reynolds at the time,
mm-hmm.
okay?
Mm-hmm.
Who was a close friend of Elizabeth mm-hmm. Taylor as well.
Okay. Okay, so let me talk a little bit about this.
Sure.
Because she lost, this was right after losing Todd, is that
yes.
correct?
Okay. Yeah, 14 months after her husband had died in a plane crash, she's already remarried with a guy she had an affair with.
Okay, so sometimes what people do is after a great loss like that, they fall into a depression. And when we fall into a depression, then the stimulation to the brain drugs get a little bit low. And so we then are more vulnerable to hook up with people who are a little bit more exciting, because there are our exciting people are the depressive person's upper.
Their cure.
They're the cure.
Okay.
Okay. So now, so she went for the upper.
And
go ahead.
We're talking about Elizabeth Taylor and mm-hmm. all the 8 marriages that she had. Of course, mm-hmm. we're going to get to the guy she married twice. Where we're Dr. Judy WTF. And if you want to talk about an affair you had or elaborate on these, and we've got more, call in. Jump on the couch.
Or if you feel, if you've been cheated on, I want to hear from you. Please pick up the phone and call in.
Area code 323-284-7826. 323-284-7826. Mm-hmm. So after she's having a relationship with Eddie Fisher, Elizabeth Taylor, she did a big, big blockbuster movie that was actually filmed in Italy, Cleopatra. Mm-hmm. And her co-star was Richard Burton. Mm-hmm. And immediately from the first time they met, it literally was love at first sight. They had a first on-screen kiss that lasted so long that the director had to ask them whether he should say cut.
Wow.
They carried on kissing.
Wow.
There was just incredible chemistry, and they could not get enough of each other.
I mean, isn't it special when we find somebody we have this incredible chemistry with? That is just so meaningful to so many people.
Absolutely.
However, unless there's a healthy human being behind the chemistry, unless there are other factors that can sustain a relationship, that one doesn't have a long shelf life either.
Well, so, interesting to say that because... they seem to enjoy hurling insults at each other and almost as if it was foreplay.
Okay, so in another episode, Walt and I talked about domestic violence and the cycle of abuse. So this hurling insults thing takes sex to a whole new level because then the makeup sex after the argument is so intense because, again,
absolutely.
Going back to cause, panel number one, the relationship with the mother, if there's ever a threat that you're going to lose your primary relationship, then you go crazy, okay? So if people are hurling insults at each other and threatening each other, there's a threat of loss, and it makes it really exciting to recapture the love object and start the whole connection again.
Well, Liz and Dick were very addicted to each other for a long, long time. What's interesting is during this time, the Vatican, because this movie Cleopatra, which almost bankrupted Paramount, because she was paid $1 million, was the first actress that ever got made that much money, and this is 63, denounced their affair as erotic vagrancy. And the problem is she pretty much thumbed her nose at obviously the Vatican, and some believe that that act and what Elizabeth Taylor did started the feminist movement.
Well, she certainly had the power. She certainly had the beauty. And
absolutely.
I think the public was so in love with her that she somehow was able to get away at thumbing her nose at
absolutely.
The Pope and still maintain her popularity.
Well, the relationship lasted 10 years. And as one person said, you cannot keep clapping a couple of sticks of dynamite together without expecting them to blow up. That's what Richard Burton said once.
And then, that's so well put because that's what they were. They were sticks of dynamite, and they were going to either implode, that means suicide, or they were going to explode and somehow, at least metaphorically, kill each other because they were killing each other every day.
They were.
Okay, with their words, right? They were destroying the relationship. And ultimately... that didn't sustain itself, but there was such a powerful core of an addiction there that the addiction kept bringing them back.
What's interesting is after 10 years of marriage, they not only imploded or exploded, they unloaded.
They unloaded.
Yes, but the problem was they couldn't stay apart.
Mm.
It says here that if they couldn't live together, it seemed they couldn't live apart. So in 1974, 16 months after a divorce in 1974, guess what they did? They remarried for the second time.
Yep, those happy endings. Yes.
Well, yeah.
Yeah.
So 4 months. Then, true to her own history, Taylor did not remember. Again, they got divorced. He bought her the 69-carat pear-shaped diamond.
Damn.
I mean, it's a gigantic diamond.
Wow.
I mean, he spent a lot of money and jewelry on Elizabeth Taylor.
Was that to make up for the...
Probably. I mean, it was kind of like what Kobe Bryant tried to do with his wife when he had an affair, right?
Mm-hmm.
Bought her a big diamond. But it was called the Burton Taylor diamond.
Mm.
So it didn't last. So they got divorced. And so 4 months after divorcing Richard Burton, husband number five, the second time, she married... a Virginia senator, so she goes for politics, a guy named John William Warner.
Sounds like a rebound relationship to me. What do you think?
Most indefinitely or most indubitably. Mm-hmm. Yep. And that relationship lasted 6 years.
Hmm.
Okay. Then she was in rehab, if those of you remember. And in 1991, she was in the Betty Ford Clinic for addiction. And she met her last husband, husband number eight, Larry Fortensky.
Okay.
And they lasted exactly 5 years together.
Was he going through rehab as well?
They met at the Betty Ford Clinic.
Okay, so so he was going through rehab as well.
Both
so
were
they
going
had
through
something.
Rehab.
They had that, something deeply in common.
Very much so.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So look at all the layers of addiction. There was a alcohol addiction on the part of her last husband, Elizabeth, and Richard Burton was a heavy alcoholic.
Yes, he was. Yes, he was.
14 in fact, when they first Bloody Marys,
the
or
first
something.
Time they met, the first time they met, he was so hungover that he was trying to drink a cup of hot coffee. And what Elizabeth Taylor did, and this was one of the first times, or the first time they met, is he came over and his hands were shaking so much that she actually helped him hold the coffee and helped him drink the coffee. And that sort of connection and intimate moment got the whole thing rolling. So I mean, from day one, Richard Burton was just a huge alcoholic.
So from moment one, she supported him even in his worst moment.
She was his codependent.
That's right. And then he hers.
Yes, of course. Right.
Yeah.
But then, but wait, there's more. Well, not Elizabeth Taylor. Of course, another famous
there's
one.
Always more.
There's always more. There's always more.
Humphrey, people having affairs.
Humphrey Bogart, Humphrey Bogart and Lauren Bacall.
Okay.
And this was interesting is they were in a movie together. She was 19 years old and he was 44. And he was on his third marriage, ironically enough, and it was deteriorating. And everybody could see their love right there on the celluloid. And says their son, Stephen, they eventually got married, I'll give you that. He was the great love of her life, and she his. Okay, so they had an affair, and actually this one was wife number four, Lauren Bacall was to Humphrey Bogart, and it actually died. He died from cancer a year after he was diagnosed, and they stayed married until he died. What's interesting is, this is interesting, this is from Lauren Bacall's perspective. I realized that one way to hold my trembling head together, because she was so nervous hanging around Humphrey Bogart in their first movie, was to keep her chin low, almost to her chest, and her eyes up, which became the infamous look that was known for Lauren Bacall. So I thought that was interesting.
Well, let's talk for a moment about her self-esteem. She's 19 years old.
19 years old.
Okay, and she's a star. Is she a star at this point?
Well, she's becoming a star. She's a starlet.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So think about what a 19-year-old woman is doing with a 43-year-old man who's been divorced.
44-year-old
man who's been divorced how many times?
Twice his age. And he was working, working or finishing, I should say, his third marriage.
Okay, third marriage. Okay. So one of the reasons we call the show W.T. Freud is because people repeat patterns. I'd be really, really interested to know.
I thought it was What the Fun.
Well, it's anything we want it to be.
True.
It's anything we want it to be, okay?
What the Freud? WTF with this.
Okay, so here's a What the Freud situation. I mean, What the Freud? If I were that woman's parent, I'd be thinking, say what?
No, okay. It's Humphrey Bogart.
Okay.
But he was a real sweetheart in real life. Yeah, obviously had a different persona on screen.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Okay.
But for the next year when they first met, they held clandestine tourists every single chance they could.
Right.
Before they got married.
Right. Okay. So when that lust kicks in and when that chemical bonding takes place, wild horses, as they say, can't keep people away. And look at this situation. I mean, let's look back on the Elizabeth Taylor, Richard Burton situation.
Yeah.
Wild horses.
No,
it's just like,
absolutely not.
Right. Even after umpteen marriages, they
she
still.
She even said he was. I mean, obviously, she married him twice. But she said Elizabeth Taylor said about Richard Burton that he was the one. I mean, he was the one that kept her the most attention and all that. I mean, a mess of a relationship, but that was the way it was.
So this was an era again where there weren't really that many books on communication skills. No. So people did what they did, and then these were the people that the public really admired.
Well, they were huge Hollywood actors, right?
And these people represented the romance of the era.
Yes, they did.
Okay, so isn't it interesting that people having these affairs, people who were substance abusers, alcoholics, I mean, to their credit, very talented, I'm sure very wonderful people, but then the public actually put them up on a pedestal and idealized them, and they were on the screen, and this is how we were supposed to emulate our romantic lives. And if we didn't look like these people, if we didn't have the passion of these people, then there was something wrong with us.
Well, what's interesting is, for example, with the Spencer Tracy, Katharine Hepburn relationship, the press, as well as Hollywood in general, kept it under wraps. Mm-hmm. I mean, it wasn't expressed. But talk about one a little bit more current, pardon the pun, that was out in the open a little bit eventually, was JFK, John Kennedy, and Marilyn Monroe.
Boy, you're really keeping it current.
Oh, yeah, I am. What I think is hilarious, and this is a new book that just came out, is Marilyn Monroe called Jackie Kennedy pretty much toward the end, and said, hey, you know, I'm having an affair with your husband. And Jackie's response was priceless. And those of you probably haven't heard this yet. This is a direct quote, Jackie Kennedy. Marilyn, you'll marry Jack. That's great. And you'll move into the White House, and you'll assume all the responsibilities of the First Lady, and I'll move out, and you can have all the problems.
I say touche on that one.
Because obviously she knew that Marilyn wasn't the only one.
So I just for those of you who are concerned that you may be the victim of an affair, if you feel that you're being cheated on, what do you do? This is such a touchy situation. I get asked this all the time, of course, in my therapy room. What do you do if you're the cheater? What if you do if you're
being cheated on.
Yeah. And the first thing that I want to speak to is the fact that there is a lie going on. Okay, there's literally an elephant in the room, and I will be very surprised if the people involved don't really know, because I think for the most part, if they don't really know consciously, there's something in the gut that tells them that something is off.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
So first thing to do is to really, really begin to approach the elephant in the room. How do you approach an elephant? You approach the elephant carefully, and you sit down, and you start having what I call peaceful, truthful, healing conversations.
Well, there's only one way to eat an elephant and approach it. It's one bite at a time.
Right. And there's no way around it. An affair is a lie. And the only way to deal with a lie is to confront the lie, because it ain't going to get any better. It just spirals down from there. So, peaceful, truthful, healing dialogue.
Well, you're listening to Dr. Judy WTF, and right now we're going to do our Shrink That Tune, and the tune this week we've selected is Tainted Love by Soft Cell. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to read the lyrics, and Dr. Judy's going to shrink it, and then we'll play the song. So, sometimes I feel I've got to run away, I've got to get away from the pain you drive into the heart of me. The love we share seems to go nowhere, and I've lost my light, for I toss and turn, I can't sleep at night.
Okay, so I'll work backwards on this one. I've lost my light. Obviously, this person feels like the light that they've lost is that person. So without the person, without the comfort of that body next to them, they can't sleep at night. So the pain is so hurtful, the disconnect is so hurtful that they're going into a kind of a state of withdrawal here. Part of it is the sleeplessness.
Once I ran to you, now I run from you. This tainted love you've given, I'll give you all a boy could get. I give you all a boy could give. Take my tears, and that's not nearly all. Oh, tainted love.
So the very same person that person ran to and was so enamored by and so in love with is now representing something painful. So still staying on the topic of the affair, if a person's been cheated upon, they may still very much be in love with that person, but then there's this sort of a push and pull inside of them, and you know, they feel that they need to get away.
Well, now I know I've got to run away. I've got to get away. You don't really want any more from me. To make things right, you need someone to hold you tight. And you think love is to pray, but I'm sorry, I don't pray that way.
Well, I like to think of the word pray as a kind of a vampire-ish way of preying on another person. And so this person is obviously realizing that the connection is not a really healthy connection. So they want to get away, but they also feel that they've been slighted, and they want the person to know, hey, you know, you're just not going to treat me that way anymore. So I'm out.
Once I ran to you, now I run from you. This tainted love I give. Oh, of course. Okay. Don't touch me, please. I can't stand the way you tease. I love you through, though you hurt me so. Now I'm going to pack my things and go. Tainted love. Touch me, baby. Tainted love.
Okay, so let's look at the phrase, the way you tease. So they still hurt. They want the touch of that person, but they know that that person isn't necessarily good for them. So they're saying to that person, you know, I'm addicted to you, but please get away from me because I know that I am very vulnerable to you. So better that you totally get away than leave me in this kind of a tease state where I want you, but I can't really have all of you or the way that I really need to have you in a healthy way.
And we're having here Tainted Love by Soft Cell.
Yes.
Sometimes I feel I've got to run away.
Only affects the couple, but it has a lot of fallout material, because when there is an affair going on, the person having the affair oftentimes will burden their friends with the truth. And then what's a friend going to do? Is a friend supposed to keep the secret? Is a friend supposed to then go tell the husband and the wife or the lover that the person's having an affair?
Oh my
so
gosh,
because
that's very,
it gets so, you know, this
awkward.
Thing gets so weird and so messy, and then there are kids involved. involved, and what are the kids supposed to do? What if they walk into the situation? So chaos, double, triple chaos. And
as we started the show, it's the silent system changer.
Yes, because, again, the person that's being cheated on doesn't know really the truth of what's happening. All that person is experiencing is a change in the system, and that lie is eating at them, but they can't quite put their finger on what is going on.
Well, it's obviously a symptom of disconnect, but taking their lover's light to further your fake light, which is vampiring, and eventually puts them into more darkness.
When you are going outside of the system, and the person inside the system who stays in the system is in integrity, but the other one is out of integrity, and they're engaging with another person, they're using another person's light to bolster their self-esteem. So they're puffing up their ego. Okay, get the system here. So the person having an affair is going outside the relationship for a little extra hamburger helper, if you know what I mean, okay? And now they're all beefed up. They're feeling good. They come back into the relationship and into the original relationship. And now they're getting fed from both ends of the spectrum here, and they're feeling pretty pumped up. Okay, so what do you think is really going on? What's the core of this, Walt?
Well, the problem is,
when you've
run out of hamburger helper, what you need is helper.
Yeah, you need a helper. Yeah.
And we have a quick call here. We're going to give it a shot and see what we've got really fixed. Hey, thanks for calling. You're on the air with Dr. Judy, and actually on the couch with Dr. Judy. WTF, you're calling. Real quick, we got just a few more minutes.
Hi, what's your name?
I guess they hung up.
Aww.
So that was too quick. Okay.
Okay. Hopefully
they'll
call back. Okay.
And those of you actually last week that tried to call, sorry, I was not on the board and didn't work out. But nonetheless, so we are about out of time. But yeah, if you want some helper or hamburger helper, they even have tuna helper now, you know. You can write us at info@drjudywtf. Mm-hmm. And we're also on Facebook at Dr. Judy WTF and Twitter, Dr. Judy WTF.
And for those of you who wanted to call in and didn't call in, write in. And,
yeah, write us.
Yeah, please.
We'll take any and all
questions.
Absolutely.
And you can even call me. You can find me on my website and give a call. And
So, hey, folks, thanks for listening. May all your affairs be bright. Tune in next week.
It's not Christmas yet, Walt.
Well, you know, some places are retail-wise.
Okay.
We will see you next time, and we're going to close out with the ultimate love.
And remembering that the most powerful healing force on the planet
is
unconditional love.
God bless everyone.
Yes. God bless. Make it.